This program is made possible by the loyal financial support of the friends and partners of Family Policy Institute.
You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world.
Good evening and welcome to the program. Thank you for joining us. Tonight, our topic of discussion is the state of marriage in South Africa. And to help talk us through this, I've invited Costa Mitchell, the National Director of the Association of Vineyard Churches, into the studio. Costa, welcome and thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Errol.
And I've also asked Mbulelo Bikwani from Isiseko Family Institute to come in and help us understand what is happening in our country today. Mbulelo, thank you for joining us and helping us navigate this very controversial subject tonight.
Thank you very much, Errol.
Okay.
Thank you.
I want to start with you, Costa. What we see in society today from the white paper on the family released by the Department of Social Services is that only 35% of children live with both biological parents. That means that the two-parent biological family is in the minority in South Africa. And that means we're heading in altogether the wrong direction. Research from religious and secular institutions are showing us that the best place, environment to raise children is in the two-parent biological family because they fare better in all kinds of ways. Why do you think the trend we're seeing in South Africa, why do you think that is happening? What do you think are the major causes for marriage breakdown?
I think, Errol, I've been saying for a number of years, we've been seeing an erosion, a gradual erosion, of the value and the ideal of marriage. I think it started probably 20 years ago, and there was a generation that started to speak about the fact that marriage has lost its meaning. People who had grown up in some of those early broken families and who had seen so much damage done in the family home that they said they vowed they would never get married. And so, in fact, the statistics a few years ago were showing that increasing numbers of couples were living together without getting married because they didn't believe in marriage. It's an irony. They didn't realize, of course, that you're just as badly damaged when a relationship like that breaks up as if you actually divorced.
So you're saying a lot of the people today are exposed to bad role models?
Bad models, and also as a result of that, a loss of the ideal of marriage.
Of marriage, the sanctity,
yes,
of marriage, because they didn't see good,
yes,
examples of that. Now, Mbulelo, I'm going to come to you. I had an interview with Ryan Anderson, who is he's one of the most brilliant minds on the issue of marriage. He's written a book called Why Marriage Matters. And I was surprised when he said that, the question I asked him is, how did we arrive at this place? The same question I asked you, Costa, is where marriages are breaking down the way they are. And he said, well, you know, we devalued marriage. Now we're talking about same-sex marriage and all these issues. But he said, we can't blame them. It's the heterosexuals that got us to this place because we ourselves have devalued the institution of marriage. No fault divorce, living together, all these kind of things, adultery. And so the next step then is for all the other things you're seeing in society where people are arguing for group marriage, same-sex, all these things. So would you agree with that?
Absolutely. I mean, there's a narrative that has been growing over time, as Costa says. And unfortunately, there was no opposition narrative, so to speak, from those who speak for marriage. Mm-hmm. And those who hear the loudness of this narrative, which says that you need to be independent in marriage, you need to be free, and just breaking down all the principles that are biblical about marriage, and that made sense to many people. Mm. And when it made sense, they started acting it out.
Yes.
They started acting it out, and in the acting it out, those who are coming after those who acted saw nothing wrong because there was no one who was saying, this is not right. Mm-hmm. There was no one who was saying, this is not right. The church wouldn't say, this is not right. Society would actually encourage it. Mm. So I believe you are absolutely right when you say we who are in marriage are the ones who should take responsibility for this, because we should defend it what we were in, and particularly what we believe in. And unfortunately, that's what we didn't do.
Costa?
Yes, I think, Errol, the Bible says there are two things that destroy. The one is the lack of vision, and the other one is the lack of knowledge. So it actually talks about that in two senses in Scripture. And of course, the well-known one is where there is no vision, the people perish. Or a better translation of the phrase is the people cast off restraint. And of course, the initial reference when it speaks about where there is no vision was talking about the law. It was talking about God's moral code.
Yes.
And so where there is no restraint put in place by a moral code, a set of values, people cast off restraint. But that is the same thing as saying they disintegrate, they fall apart. Because it's not, marriage is not the thing that's being destroyed. The people in the marriages are being destroyed, including the children, of course.
That's right.
The second thing, of course, is where there is no, where my people perish for lack of knowledge. And knowledge has to do with the ability to both understand and apply the principles that will make marriage good and meaningful and healthy and wholesome and safe.
Now, talking about Mbulelo, talking about those principles. Now, I think you alluded to it in your previous comments that marriage is from God. We all know that it's an institution given by God. It's His idea. He's put the boundaries and the principles in place for good, healthy, strong marriages. But now we've secularized marriage. We've taken away the biblical principles, and we can say it's all about you, feelings, what you know. So we justified a whole host of things. Are you saying this also crept into the church, and that's why the church is now failing to be a good example to the world when it comes to the institution of marriage?
Well, the problem of the church in many things, the church has stopped to become involved in soul saving. Has stopped. It is a business. It is busy with other things other than soul saving. And the hurt, the pain that is in society because of breakdown of marriages, I don't think is loud enough for the church to hear and change its ways.
You're right. And I mean, we see that as well. When you just look at the stats, when you talk to people that is struggling in broken marriages and all of that. Costa, I think more people are being influenced by the media, the popular media, than they are by the Bible.
Precisely.
Even in the church, would you agree?
Absolutely. And, you know, I was thinking about it when Mbulelo was saying that. The old illustration of the frog
in the kettle.
In the kettle. So I think we've had this process of slowly eroding principles. I think you mentioned it earlier, the whole idea of the no-fault divorce, making marriage a cheap thing, an easy come, easy go, where years ago it was hard to get a divorce. Now it's a matter of 3 court days. If it's not contested, it's just dissolved like that. And there's hardly a tear shed for marriages that end. Mbulelo was talking about the principle of cleaving. It's an old-fashioned concept which basically is translated commitment. And that's something that is counter-cultural at the moment, very much so, especially even more so now in the postmodern culture, where commitment, I read an article that said commitment is an ideal that a lot of postmoderns like to hear about but don't like to do.
Yes.
And I think that is almost a commentary on society in general. There are still things that people 30, 40, 50 years ago would lay their lives down for that people will sometimes still today give a nod to. They'll say, that's a good concept, but they won't go anywhere near laying down their lives for it. And I think that that's part of a kind of general breakdown of moral fiber, a moral compass and moral fiber.
And we're seeing that in right through society.
Yeah.
In just about every area, sector of society, we see the corruption in government, in civil society. Just everything is infected with this decline of morality,
yes,
where people just don't care.
Yes.
And I think it's this, Mbulelo, it's this culture of individualism. I matter more than anything else. It's
correct.
Me, myself, and I demand my rights. It's me first. And so therefore, institutions like marriage and family then take second place.
Well, I mean, there's a book by the current Pope. I can't remember whether it's a Joy of Love, but it's a new book. He talks about this individualism and how it affects marriage, this culture of individualism, and he refers it to Europe. Africa is supposed to be communal.
Yes.
We are a communal people, but we have exported some of the values that are not our values.
Yes.
And we feel comfortable about. This whole issue of the erosion of marriage starts with the church when it is not raising its hand, when people choose their own vows. When people choose their own vows, they write their own vows. There are vows in marriage, and they have, those vows are biblical. Those vows are biblical. But couples today, in fact, in our organization, in Insego, we don't support the altering of the vows. If people want to marry and they want our support, we tell them up front, these are the vows. There is a reason why the vows are saying until death do us part. There's a critical reason.
And obviously you're referring to the biblical vows.
Absolutely.
So you're saying people are changing that, they want to make their own vows, take that out.
Yes.
And you know,
It's very me, it's what you were saying earlier. It's about individualism.
So we're facing a huge problem in South Africa because marriage breakdown is endemic in our society, and that of course leads to the breakdown of the family, and family breakdown now can be traced to just about every social ill in our society.
Absolutely.
Everything is affected by family breakdown. And I often, when I go around the country speaking to churches, I tell them, look, we can't rebuild a society on government programs and on money and all these kind of things. God started with a marriage and a family. If we're going to rebuild and strengthen society, we have to start at the same place, which is marriage and family. But we don't see a lot of that being discussed in the media and sadly, Costa, not in the church as well. Yeah. Now, it is really concerning to discover that marriage breakdown, divorces, separations, is rife in the church.
It is.
It's amongst pastors. I've heard of so many pastors now separated from their wives, wanting to get divorced. And so people are sitting in the pews and looking at this and probably saying, you know, if my pastor can divorce his wife and just continue in the pulpit, then I can divorce my wife as well. So if I've got any kind of problem going on here, the way out is divorce.
Again, it's role models.
Role models. And yet the Bible is so clear in Ecclesiastes, it says God hates divorce, and that hasn't changed.
No, quite. And again, Errol, I want to come back to what Mbulelo was referring to earlier about the individualism thing, because I think it actually starts with a false gospel.
Yep.
It's not only about false teaching and false models, but it starts with a false gospel that basically, again, it comes back to that concept of the gospel is about me. The gospel is about me getting something out of God, you know. Just believe enough, follow these seven principles and you'll get, you know, health, wealth, happiness, a lower golf handicap and more money in the bank and the best wife that you can imagine. It's changing the ideal or the focus of the gospel from God and his glory to me and my comfort, and my joy, and you know, my happiness.
Yes,
I often say some gospels that I hear being preached is the American dream baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. It's not the biblical gospel, which is this one, that Jesus says, come, take up your cross, follow me.
Yes.
And by the way, it's going to cost you everything.
But there's a reason why we hear this message and why it's so popular, because it appeals to people, to their carnal natures.
Sure.
It's about me. God wants me to be happy. Yes. God wants me to have lots of money and nice things. And so that's all I seek to do. So, Mbulelo, if you take this into the institution of marriage, then, if this message of it's about me and my comforts, we can see how devastating that message is.
Yes, it's because if I don't get that in marriage, then I want to get out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's simple as that.
It's simple as that. If I'm not happy, and it has stopped about this marriage is a ministry that God has given to me for my wife.
Very good.
And it's a ministry that was given to my wife to minister to me.
That's correct. Yeah.
And if we stop doing that, then we have a problem.
Yes.
And a bigger problem, because it then becomes about our happiness. It's not about my happiness, about my wife's happiness, yes. which depends on me. And I must give that happiness without any expectation of a benefit.
Yeah, and look, Mbulelo, this is all in the Bible. This is nothing new, because in Ephesians 5, verse 20, husbands, love your wives as Christ loves the church. And it's so clear. How did Christ love the church? He gave his life for the church. He washes and cleanses the church with his word. So, if we're wondering how does a husband love his wife and take care of her, the Bible is very clear. In fact, in three different scriptures, it commands men to love their wives.
And lay down their lives for them.
Exactly. So there's no real ambiguity or confusion with this. It's just that we're ignoring it and it's not coming a lot from the pulpit. But Costa Mbulelo, we want to talk more about this, and especially the church, because I believe the church has a huge impact on society, what's happening in society. If it goes this way in the church, I believe it goes the same way in society. So we want to talk more about the church and its role and its example in society, especially when it comes to vital institutions like marriage and family. So don't go away. More with Costa and Mbulelo after the break. Welcome back to the program. We're talking about the state of marriage in South Africa. And to help us talk through this, I've invited Costa Mitchell from the Vineyard Fellowship of Churches and Mbulelo Bikwani, who is from Isiseko Family Institute. And we're talking about the state of marriage in society, but more importantly, in the church. Now, people are saying, Costa, that it's the same. Divorce is the same rate in the church as it is in society, outside the church. I don't believe that is true, but if you look at the rates of divorce and separation in the church, it is very worrying. Yes. And mainly because we are the trustees of the truth of God's word. And marriage, the Bible is very clear that marriage is a holy, sacred institution for life. But we're not seeing this in the church. And why are we not seeing that?
Again, I think the issue is a loss of direction. And as you said, maybe the statistics are not exactly the same in the church and outside of the church. But even if they were only a half, even if they were a third of what is going on in the world, that would still be too much. And I think we have, it starts once again with a compromise of a principle. And once you've done that, it's very hard to apply a different principle in any individual situation. So I remember an occasion when there was a quite prominent person, leader in a church, who was divorcing his wife, and I was speaking to one of his leaders and saying, isn't there something that one can do, we can do about this and to help? And he said, no, and we as leaders decided he deserves to be happy.
Wow.
And I thought, wow, gee, is that the basis on which we're going to make decisions now about who is appointed to leadership? I think the Apostle Paul would be having a, spinning in his grave right now, thinking about the fact that we are now making it up to the happiness of the leader being the criterion on which we decide should this person still be in leadership?
Yeah, and I think what we said earlier is it comes back to what we're preaching from the pulpit. So if people, it's about my happiness and about me and not serving God and even sacrificing to advance God's kingdom and to uphold His principles and all of that. So we've made it so easy in the church now that you can get divorced and you can do all kinds of things as long as I'm happy. That seems to be the overriding message and concern.
In fact, this is even more disturbing when you find someone who joins a church clean, no adulterous relationships, and he starts them when he joins a church, because that is the culture that he got himself into. And I've seen it. That's how bad the church is. Now, we talk church generally, and when I'm saying the church is, I'm talking about the experiences that I have seen personally. And why is that so? It's because we have taken God out of marriage. We can't do these things if God was part of our marriages. We just can't. We've decided to ask God to give us some space in our marriages so that we can do what we want to do with our marriages. Mm. Until we bring back God and God becomes the center of our marriages, then we will see a turnaround, and the church needs to lead that. Mm. There is no other institution that is going to lead that.
So we've de-sanctified marriage then, yes, as an institution. We've done that in the church. It's coming from the pulpit. Costa, we see senior leaders in churches divorcing their wives, taking some time out, remarrying, but continuing to lead in the church. And that message that is being sent out to millions of people, it is that it's okay. Divorce is okay. If you've got a good enough excuse, you can do that. But God says divorce is not okay. God, yes, hates divorce because of the damage it causes to men and women and to children.
Yes.
It will never be okay.
You see, I think that is the message we need to repeat. And I remember being filled with admiration by observing a leader who was in that situation where he was divorced for no fault of his own. It was a case of his wife made that decision. But he also then said, I have two options. I will stay single, and so that I can continue in ministry or come back into ministry after recovering, or I will, if I remarry, it will be on the basis that I take a different role in terms of ministry. And he said, I'm doing that because I want to honor what God says about the ideal. Now, I also know that years ago we had a legalistic approach to the idea, and there were people who were, in many cases, the victims of the divorce. The innocent party. Innocent party in a divorce situation, who were then also excluded from leadership, from ministry, and sometimes even from communion in churches. And that was also, I think, a wrong application of the scripture, because I don't think that's what Jesus meant when he spoke about that. I think what he was doing was he was trying to uphold a value, but at the same time he was saying, if and when it happens for these reasons, these are basically putting you back into a place of grace. Yeah. And so we do need to apply grace, and we do need to, my answer over the years has been, take each case on its merits, but at the same time, keep the principle upheld, which is that no matter what the reason for a divorce is, the beginning of restoration of that person is repentance for the fact that the divorce happened. Because in a way, there is no such thing as a completely innocent party. There's some place in which we've fallen down. The way that Jesus says it is for your hardness of heart.
We've devalued marriage in the family. It doesn't hold that lofty position it once held. You know, marriage between a man and a woman is for life. That people before they got married, and you alluded to this, Mbulelo, is that they knew why they were getting married. They knew what they were getting into because they went and they received the counsel, and so they were well prepared for it. So today, people are not well prepared for marriage. That's why some marriages are lasting 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, and it's over. Most of them are failing in the first 3 years because they're not prepared properly. And I think, again, it's because we've just taken God out of the marriage, as you said. We've removed the principles. We've made everything so easy. We've been deceived by this culture, the narrative in the culture, this disposable society. If it doesn't work, just, you know, get a divorce and find somebody else. It will be better. There's this lie that when you get divorced, you'll be happy. Get somebody else so you can be happy. And people are never happy when they get divorced. This thing goes with you for the rest of your life, mm-hmm. because you're tearing something apart that God has put together. And that's why the Bible says what God has put together, let not man put it asunder. So just your comments on, Mbulelo, maybe on how do you think we can reverse this trend starting in the church?
Well, in God's heart, there are two institutions that really are close to his heart. It is the church and marriage. Hence Ephesians 5 uses the church to describe marriage.
Yes.
It's because those two institutions, and one impacts the other. The church impacts marriage, and marriage impacts the church.
Very good.
The health of the church depends on healthy marriages within the church. And therefore, the church needs to start to prioritize marriage in its important agenda items. Marriage should come first. Whatever the church does, I mean, I talk to pastors and I say to them, you think you can build the family of God without knowing whether the smaller families in that big family are healthy enough to impact the bigger family in a positive way?
That's right.
Unless you do that, unless you as a pastor, you make sure that people who are married in your congregation have healthy marriages, you are not contributing to the glory of God, because marriage is about the glory of God. So I believe we need to be much more intentional around bringing back the glory of God, true marriage.
I think that's a great word you use there, Mbulelo, intentional. I think there's no intent in the church to focus on the institution of marriage, even though we have this crisis, because I had a pastor call me and he said, you know, in my church alone, we have had three or so incidences of adultery. And now, you know, I will focus and concentrate on the issue of marriage a lot more because I've had this happen. So there was no intent maybe before to, you know, and you say that, I think everybody knows it in the church, pastors preach this from the pulpit, that marriage is from God. It's a, you know, a cornerstone institution. It's so important to the health and welfare of our families, our church, our society at large. We all know that, but we're not doing enough in the church. And obviously, Costa, we can see by the results, by the crisis we're currently facing, is that we're not focusing on important institutions like marriage and family. Otherwise, we won't be having the kind of situation we have today.
We're reaping what we've sown.
That's right.
So again, it comes back. I was thinking as you were speaking about that, or as Mbulelo was speaking about it as well, the principle in Romans 10, 9 and 10, that says if you believe in your heart that, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. It goes on to say, with the heart we believe and so we are justified, with the mouth we confess and so we are saved. And that word actually is talking about becoming whole or being made whole. So it's the outworking of salvation that comes about through confession. So I think that it goes back to, what are we preaching? What are we confessing? Are leaders standing up and saying, I want you to hold me accountable for this, that marriage is sacred to me, my own marriage is sacred to me. If you see me neglecting my wife, if you see her being unhappy and I'm not fulfilling my role of loving her better, challenge me. And I ask you to hold me accountable publicly. A late friend and mentor of mine came out of the drug and music culture, became a Christian, and he and his wife were separated at the time. He went home after he became a believer and found that she had become a Christian in his absence. So the two of them met. They had left, separated as unbelievers, came back together, and they found that they'd both become born again. And he said, we looked at each other, we stood in the living room, and he says, the best we could do was shake hands. And we shook hands across that living room, and we said, I don't think I love you. I probably don't even like you, but I want you to know something. Because I've been born again and because of God's word, I will never allow the word divorce to cross my lips.
Wow.
And they not only survived, went into ministry and did fantastic things for God, but they had a model marriage by the time he died. Their marriage was spoken about broadly. So I believe that what we've got to do is to create our own boundaries.
Yes.
And that comes from leadership, and it comes from speaking that truth, confessing that, and holding ourselves accountable to some standards again.
Yeah. I think, you know, from the leadership, we need the example being set. And so when leaders lead and they, you know, they convey this message from the pulpit and wherever they are, that marriage is sacred, it's holy, and divorce is unacceptable. And they role model that. And if a leader is having problems in his marriage, to step down and say, I'm going to take time out to deal with my issues and then come back, is a lot better than just continuing, because a lot of humility is needed. And tragically, you know, what is seeping into the pews, into the ordinary congregation, is they see all of this and they believe and they follow those examples. And so people are divorcing wives and, you know, not sacrificing, going through, you know, it's a painful process. When there's problems in a marriage, to go through and take the time to get counseling and all of that. But it's so vital and it's so important to do that, because I believe that's where you really honor God. Because all of us can face problems. However, is how we deal with it that's important. And this is where you really honor God, is that, look, I'm having problems here, but you know, Lord, like you said, that gentleman said, divorce is never going to cross my lips. It's one thing I cannot do because God hates it. And if God hates it, there must be a very good reason for it. If God hates it, I hate it too. And I'm going to stay away from this thing. God has created marriage to be a lifelong institution. I know that. So I'm committed to that. I'm going to honor God, never mind what it costs. Is this what the Bible is saying?
Absolutely. Absolutely. A simple example, there's a Nigerian pastor, Adeboye. Now Adeboye has about 10 million members around the world. And he was telling his own story, where one of his own congregants came and said, I have dreamt that God said, you are going to be my husband. He's the pastor of the church. In fact, he's the general overseer of the church. And he's married. He had to deal with that. And he rebuked that spirit publicly. He rebuked that spirit. Now, that's an opportunity for some of the pastors who want to hold the snake in a corner, would find a way of dealing with that. So that's exactly what Costa was talking about, that leadership is important. And leadership must not just walk the talk. They must first walk, and after walking, then they can tell people what they have been doing. Because the talk is cheap.
Yes.
There's a big gap between talking and walking. So they must walk first. And after doing the right thing and come to people and say, this is what I'm doing. This is my life. And the church, I believe the health of marriages depend on the church.
Yes, it does.
We just cannot run away from that. The health of marriages depend on the church. Because if those marriages in the church can be healthy, then those marriages would be able to infect the ones outside. The reason why the courts are very casual about marriage is because the church has become casual.
Casual. Correct.
Yes.
Correct. And judgment begins in the house of God. I'm so sorry we ran out of time on this segment, but Mbulelo and Costa, I want to thank you so much for coming in. I know you're great champions of marriage. You're great examples, and we're looking for more good examples on marriage because we're so concerned with what is happening. But I believe we can reverse this. And it's going to take those things that we spoke about here. It's about repentance and humility and sacrifice and all of the good things that the Bible teaches us. But I think we can restore marriage in South Africa. So, Costa Mbulelo, once again, thank you for coming into the studio. And next up after the break, we're going to be talking to Bridget Masango. She is the DA's Shadow Minister for Social Development. And we're going to be talking about the PRASA crisis that you've been watching on your TV screens. Don't go away. Welcome back to the program. It's my great privilege to welcome into the studio Bridget Masango. Bridget is the Shadow Minister for Social Development in the South African Parliament, and she represents the Democratic Alliance. Bridget, welcome into the studio.
Thank you so much, Errol, for having me.
Now, you're the Shadow Minister for Social Development, and you're dealing with this whole SASSA debacle that has taken place over the past few weeks that has had South Africans enthralled, glued to their TV sets. And I just want to ask you a little bit about the process. How did we get to where we are today that, you know, this issue had to end up in the Constitutional Court, that the Chief Justice had to call it a crisis, even though the Minister, Bathabile Dlamini, says it's not, and the President, Jacob Zuma, says it's not a crisis. The court had to rule and put stringent measures in place to make sure that welfare recipients receive their payouts on the 1st of April. How did we arrive at this place?
Well, Errol, I'll give you a very short version of how we got to this place. This dates back in 2012, when the SASSA contract was granted after a bidding process. And after the awarding of the contract had been done, some bidders who did not win the tender took the whole thing to court, citing all sorts of irregularities on the bid. And then in 2014, the Constitutional Court declared the CPS SASSA contract as invalid. But it had to suspend the invalidity declaration to ensure that no disruption of the payments of the grants happens, because obviously at the time we had about 10 million beneficiaries of the grants. So since then, the court ordered that SASSA would report to the court on what the process is, or what the progress is in ensuring that by the time the contract ends, because when this invalidity declaration was suspended, the court said the contract must live to the end of its life, which is the 31st of March 2017. But then during that time, there were what we called the deliverables that SASSA submitted to the court to say, this is how we are going to ensure that come the 31st of March, we are able to take over or to institutionalize the grant payment system in this country. So I want to then fast forward to the 7th of June 2016, when we were in a meeting and we had received as the portfolio committee the reports that had been prepared by the department or by the agency themselves. When we didn't see anything drastic being communicated to say, as the 31st of March is coming next year, meaning now 2017, this is what we have planned to do. And this is how we have responded to the Constitutional Court, or reported to the Constitutional Court, to ensure that the institutionalization happens without any disruption to the payment of the 17 million beneficiaries that receive grants. So I wrote a letter on the 7th of June to the chairperson of the portfolio committee to say, please, will you ask the minister to come with the department and the agency to present to us as the committee of parliament, what are the plans for taking over the payment of grants to South Africans.
As from the 1st of April?
As for the 1st of April 2017. This is now June last year.
Okay, so you called on Minister of Social Services,
yes.
Batabile Dlamini,
yes,
to come to Parliament,
yes,
and to make a report to the Portfolio Committee on Social Services,
yes,
which
yes,
you serve on,
yes,
and to find out what they've done, what yep, measures they put in place to ensure that the South African Social Security Agency, that is SASSA, what measures they put in place to ensure that the grants are paid from the 1st of April onwards.
Yes, yes.
What happened then?
Well, the minister didn't come as per invitation, but the chairperson didn't respond to my letter. Instead, at the next meeting, the chairperson told me that I'm not supposed to summon the minister. The minister may be invited and she may attend. Now, I do not, obviously, I did not welcome that or receive that well, because the reason why we have portfolio committees of the various portfolios is to hold the executive to account.
That's right.
As members of parliament.
So that's the job of parliament?
Yes.
Elected by the people,
yes,
to hold the executive accountable,
yes,
for their actions.
Yes.
That's your constitutional responsibility.
It is.
And so this person is saying to you that you have no right to invite the minister to hold it to account,
yes,
which you are constitutionally obligated to do.
Yes. That is.
Isn't that happened. Incredible?
It is staggering. But what we then did, I didn't stop, obviously, because we still needed to know what was going on. And at the meetings that the minister would attend, I want to just cite one specific meeting that proved to us, more than it had been proven before, that the minister was creating this emergency to make sure that at the end of the day, CPS is the only provider for this service to the agency. So at this meeting, the minister came and was with the officials of the department and the officials of SASSA. So I asked a pointed question, a question that says, Minister, would you please tell us who is going to pay the grants? How are the grants going to be paid? In essence, I am asking you, Minister, to give me or give this committee the plans that you have made to ensure that the institutionalization of a grant payment system is in order for the 31st of March. And the minister said, I am not going to be pushed to reveal who is going to do this because I don't want to put the people that we're working with as lives at risk.
What did that mean?
You tell me. That's my line. I at that stage, one of the members of the portfolio members of the ANC said that is not acceptable. A member of parliament in this parliament cannot ask a question and be told what you're telling her now.
Wow.
But the bottom line is that the meeting ended, was adjourned, and there was no answer to the question.
Because there was no plans put in place.
Because there was no plans put
and
in
so
place.
It was a major cover-up. So now we fast forward to where we are now. It then was obviously revealed that that SASSA could not continue with the payments to the beneficiaries as from the 1st of April 2017. Yeah. And we arrived at this crisis. Yeah. And again, we want to repeat that the Minister of Social Development, Batabile Dlamini, said there is no crisis. The president on this debate, this crisis of the payments of grants to the beneficiaries, which is about 16 or 17 million people that depend on it, that this isn't a crisis, but then it ended up in the Constitutional Court. A number of organizations, Black Sash and a few others,
Freedom Under Law,
mm-hmm, took the Department of Social Development to court and SASSA. And the court then made its ruling that they have to keep cash paymaster services, which is CBS, they have to keep them on for another year to ensure that people, the beneficiaries of the grants, are paid for the next 12 months. But they put strict measures in place. One of the things that came out was that CBS was selling the information of the grant beneficiaries. They were selling it to other organizations that were part of their group. And they were selling them loans and insurance and all kinds of things, and that was illegal.
That is, yes, I agree totally with the background you're giving, Errol. And that issue of illegal deductions is a huge thing. As the Democratic Alliance, I went around the country just talking to people who may have been affected, because people write to us all the time and they call us and they say that I am a grandmother of 72 years old. I receive grants for my grandchildren whose mother has passed away, and I received my grant today and all I got was 250 rand. And this continues to happen. How can you help me? So we went and did what we call My SASSA Story. And the stories that you hear are so sad. But going back to you, to your question about CPS and the subsidiaries of actually NetOne, who owns CPS, the subsidiaries are all sorts of small little, well, not so small little companies that are selling anything from airtime to electricity to insurance to, we heard the most bizarre story of a person who was sold a retrenchment cover at 70. So that didn't make sense to us. How does a 70-year-old buy a retrenchment cover?
And so CBS is selling this information of the grant beneficiaries, their names, telephone numbers, ID numbers. Yes. They're selling it to their subsidiaries.
Yes.
They then in turn are going to these people and selling them insurance that they don't need, airtime, all kinds of things. But yet in the contract, it says that they cannot do that. They're not allowed to share the information that was given to them to pay these grants.
Not at all. The information of the grant beneficiaries has to be totally and utterly confidential. It may not be sold. This is why part of the application by Black Sash included that specifically to say it needs to be ensured that that information is not shared.
And thankfully, the Constitutional Court made that ruling that they cannot share information of the grant beneficiaries for the next 12 months as they make these payments. And because there isn't anybody else to do it, the court reluctantly had to keep the contract in place, even though it's invalid, had to keep it in place for the next 12 months so that people can receive their payments.
Yes.
But now coming back to the minister, Batabeli Dlamini,
yes.
She still holds her position despite all this crisis, debacle, incompetence, everything that you know you could call it. You know, Bridget, I invited you in because you're a Christian.
Mm-hmm.
You're a follower of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
God, I believe God has placed you in this position for a time such as this.
Yes.
So it's so important that you're there. You did such a great job with this. You know, flying up and down from Cape Town to Johannesburg to be at the Constitutional Court. You made such an incredible speech in Parliament on this issue, calling the minister out. And so I don't want to say that we're proud of you for your stance and how you're dealing with the situation. But here's the question. The million-dollar question is, from your perspective, do you see this crisis a result of corruption? Is it corruption that is at the sort of foundation of everything that is happening with regard to the minister, SASSA, CPS, all of it?
Yes, I don't have the evidence to put on the table, Errol, but anyone should tell me why the minister would do everything in her power to block any other alternative service provider to be brought on board to actually do this work at the expense of the taxpayers. Because there was a time when I was asking the minister when she was in Parliament on another day, what if CPS says, because now they are having an upper hand. What if they say, I don't want a year, I want 2 years. And I want to increase the per person or per transaction rate. What happens then? Because there is no budgetary plan that has been put to us to actually approve as the committee. And you are so right. For anyone to go to the lengths that the minister has gone, to make sure that CPS is left alone as the only service provider that can do this work, can only be explained to have some very deep corruption undertones.
I read a report somewhere that CPS made about 2 billion, over
yes.
2 billion rand in this payment, you know, executing the payments of the grants, over
yes.
2 billion rand,
yes.
And that as their contract was coming to an end on 31st March 2017, they were actually asking for an increase. They wanted more money for that.
They were.
But now the court has ruled that they don't get any increase,
yes.
And that the Treasury now has to oversee everything. They have to give financial reports, all of that, to ensure that there is no corruption.
Yes. Yes, that's what the Constitutional Court said, to say the minister has to report on affidavit every 3 months. And if there's any changes to the payment part of this thing, Treasury has to be brought on board. And the Constitutional Court is not going to accept anything that does not have the signature of National Treasury. And that is to safeguard any possibilities of anything like corruption and all those things happening. Because we even had the minister sit before SCOPA for a hearing to say what is going on, and the minister still didn't give any details. And you will recall that for each payment that is made, 16 rand 44 cent is being paid to CPS. And so this is why the Concord said, you do this at the rates that have been agreed for the now expiring contract. With no increase.
Okay.
Yes.
So, you know, we thank God for the Constitutional Court and for the Chief Justice. He overruled the minister and the president by saying this is a crisis.
Yes.
He even castigated the lawyer and the minister in his deliberations, saying that this is gross incompetence. He couldn't explain. He wanted an explanation how this could happen, how the minister could not know that SASSA was not, not ready to make the payments from the 1st of April. That for 6 months they knew it, but the minister didn't know. It is incredible. It's mind-boggling when you think of the level of incompetence and the fact that the minister still holds a position, and the fact that the president still defends and protects the incompetence of many in his cabinet. And but the people are watching, Bridget.
Yes.
And again, I want to say we're so grateful and that you are there.
Yes.
A strong woman of godly values that's taking a stand against corruption. Yes. And we believe God has placed you, again, I want to say that, in Parliament for a time such as this. So what's the next steps, Bridget? What are you going to be demanding from the minister? Are you going to continue with the call for her to resign? And, after CPS's contract runs out in 12 months, what happens then?
Yes, what we've done, these are the actions that we've actually done. We've asked for the minister, as you say rightly, to either resign, do the honourable thing and resign, or for the president to fire her, because he's the only one that can hire or fire the cabinet. And also we've written to the public protector to look at, among other things, the relationship between the minister and CPS, and to also look at the conduct of the minister as it pertains to her oath of office, to see what could have been done better there. And also what we have done is write to the Speaker of Parliament and ask her to immediately institute an ad hoc committee. That ad hoc committee must look, again, among other things, it must look at the conduct or the role of CPS, the role of Serge Bellerman, who is the CEO of CPS, to look at the role of the former and current ministers of social development, because this dates back way back, and then also to look at the role of current and former CEOs.
Okay, so you're asking then for an extensive, comprehensive
investigation,
going back maybe to 2008, previous ministers of social development. How did we arrive at this place? And of course, having to look at, is there any corrupt dealings or connections between the Department of Social Services and SASSA and CPS? I believe there is. I think most South Africans believe there has to be.
Yes.
Because otherwise you can't explain this debacle in any other way. So, you know what, as South Africans, we're going to be praying. We really need to pray for our government and for everything that's happening, for people like you. The opposition parties, holding our executive to account, which is so important. Imagine if we didn't do that, what the situation would be. So, Bridget Masango, again, I want to thank you for coming into the studio, for your strong stand, for the great work you're doing in Parliament as the Shadow Minister for Social Development. And we just trust that you're going to get to the bottom of this, and that obviously the people of South Africa are the ones that's going to benefit from the great work you're doing. So thanks for coming in.
Thank you so much, Errol.
Don't forget to go to our website, familypolicyinstitute.com, and subscribe to my newsletter. Until next week, thank you for tuning in. God bless and good night.